Bobby Brown and I have been friends for 20, 25 years, and we're in the presence of baseball royalty. He's really had four different and distinct and distinctive careers. Baseball player for the New York Yankees, military doctor in Korea and Japan, cardiologist in Fort Worth, and American League president in New York City. To tell you a little bit more about him, he was a phenom coming out of high school, but he wanted to go to college and become a doctor. So he put off signing until a baseball contract until he was after his first year at the Tulane Medical School, and he signed for a bonus of $52,000, which tied for the top bonus paid to any player at that time. He went on to play third base for the Yankees from 1947 through 1952, and then again in 1954. Third baseman, appeared in four World Series, and four of those years he was attending the Tulane Medical School in the offseason. In four World Series, he hit .439, 18 for 31 with five doubles and three triples. That's the highest batting average in history for anyone with 20 or more bats in the World Series. Of course, he played with the great players, great Yankees of the time. Joe DiMaggio, he was Yogi Berra's first roommate. Played with Mantle, Whitey Ford. Played under Casey Stengel. And then he had his baseball career interrupted in his prime by being called to serve in the Korean conflict for 2 years. When he returned in 1954, he rejoined the Yankees, and then he's 29 years old, and believe it or not, he walks away from the New York Yankees on June 30th, takes a red-eye flight from Fenway Park to San Francisco to start his cardiology residency July 1st at Stanford. He settled in Fort Worth, where he practiced cardiology for 25 years. He was a very distinguished cardiologist, and I was privileged a few years ago to attend the dedication of the Gogans Brown Regional Heart Center at the Baylor All Saints Hospital, named after his mentor and him. Then he was called to serve as American League president, and he did so from 1984 through 1994. So you're in for a real treat, and it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Bobby Brown.
Well, I've always had a tremendous, almost avid interest in reading. I can remember when I started reading early in school, I read everything I could get my hands on about, you know, baseball Joe at Yale and all that stuff. You know, I just read all those darn books. And I read I sold the Collier's magazine, and the Saturday Evening Post and Collier's came out, and they had serials in there and whatnot. But I read everything I could get my hands on. And still do. And I spent a tremendous amount of time in the libraries. And I told Paul coming over here that my wife and I courted her in the library at Tulane. I mean, that's where we went every damn night, because I had to study. I just couldn't fool around. And I told him she wouldn't date me on the weekend. I didn't dance well enough. So I had this the weeknights, but we went to the library, and I couldn't waste a minute. But I just have always been a reader, and I think most of the students that do well all like to read, and I think that libraries are a big part of their life. And I never get tired of walking in the library and looking at all the books and whatnot. I never get tired of that. And I know when I was on the road with the Yankees and whatnot, that you know, I'd rather go to a library than go to a bar, because I wasn't a drinker. But I just enjoyed libraries, always have. And I've always been a reader, always. Yes, Yogi has never changed from the first day that I met him. All of the acclaim that he has received, and you know, he's a really an American icon. And you can go anywhere and talk about Yogi Berra, and they know who you're talking about. And he's always been the same, and he's got a good mind. And if you analyze what he says, it's usually very profound. It's the words that get a little bit jumbled. He's relatively formally educated, but he has a good brain, and it works well. And he's a super guy. He's just a super guy, and he had super athletic ability. And it was just wonderful to see him do as well as he has. At Newark, when I signed my first contract, they sent me to Newark in the International League. That was a Triple-A team. And my roommate was Yogi Berra. We were called up to the Yankees at the end of the International League season on September the 22nd. And I drove Yogi over to the Yankee Stadium, and we played our first game. The Boston Red Sox had clinched the pennant, so it was a pretty relaxed atmosphere since the games weren't really going to mean much of anything. But this particular game, our first game, was very important to the fellow that was pitching for the Yankees. His name was Spud Chandler, and he had won 19 games, and now he was going to go for his 20th. And the difference between 19 and 20 wins probably was anywhere from $15,000 to $20,000. So Spud Chandler, who was 38 and who was weaned on a lemon, he was such a caustic guy. He was extremely displeased that he had two rookies trying for his 20th game. One was going to catch him, and the other was going to play shortstop. And he didn't mind voicing his sentiments to the various teammates in the clubhouse. And of course, Yogi and I could hear every one of those complaints. And Yogi was petrified. He said, "What am I going to do?" Well, I said, "What you need to do is go talk to that old man and try to get your sign straight." And what had happened to Spud was that starting at age 31 or 2, he threw just as hard as ever, but the ball just didn't go as fast. And when that occurred, he decided that he would add new pitches to his repertoire. So now he's 38, and he threw a fastball. He threw a sinker. He threw a change of pace. He threw a slow curve. He threw a fast curve. He threw a screwball, and he threw a knuckleball. So Yogi went to him, and he's over there while I'm watching him, and Yogi's talking to him and looking at his hands and whatnot, and they're getting the sign straight. And Yogi came back to me, and I said, "How'd you do?" He says, "I'm screwed." I said, "What do you mean?" "He's got more pitches than I got fingers." But we got through the game, and Spud got his 20th win, so we were off to a good start. But I knew from talking to Yogi that he was different. He told me when we first met, "Don't expect to hit any balls very far in Florida." I said, "No, why not?" I was thinking maybe that wind blew in off the Gulf and the ocean against the left-hand hitters, usually coming in from the right field. I said, why do you think balls don't travel very far in Florida? He says, "The humidity is too damn thick down there." Now, he was a bad ball hitter, and I don't know if you know what that terminology means in baseball. You know, a strike zone in baseball is measured from the knees, used to be from the upper part of the knee to now might be the lower part of the knee, and it's to a line that's drawn across the chest, imaginary horizontal line that's between the belt and the shoulders, the top of the shoulders. And it has to be over the plate, which is 17 inches wide. So if you hit a ball in that strike zone, you have a much better chance of hitting it decently if it was out of the strike zone. But Yogi's strike zone was anything that he could reach, he thought was his strike zone. And he was a very, very good bad ball hitter. Now, in 1947, we had two coaches that came over to the Yankees from the National League, Charlie Dressen and Red Corden. And Charlie Dressen analyzed Yogi's hitting, and he committed the sin of trying to fix something that wasn't broken. And he told Yogi that if he just hit balls in the strike zone, instead of hitting 315 or 320, he might hit 360. He said, you've got to be more selective if you're going to hit. And you've got to wait for that ball in that strike zone, and then you've got to swing at it and hit it. He says, you've got to think when you're up there. So the game started. After this advice, Yogi went up there. First ball pitch, strike one, he doesn't move. Second ball pitch, strike two, he doesn't move. Third ball pitch, strike three, he doesn't move. He comes back to the bench. I said, what's wrong with you? He says, no one can think and hit at the same time. He played some outfield because he was an excellent athlete. You wouldn't believe it from looking at him, but he was an excellent athlete. He could run well, and he had a great arm. And so late in his career, when they got Elston Howard, who also was a very fine catcher, they used to put Yogi in left field. Left field in the Yankee Stadium was very difficult to play, especially in the fall, because the sun got lower in the sky, and they came in, the rays of the sun came in right over the roof of the Yankee Stadium, and it was a terrible, terrible deal for the left fielder to catch balls out there with that sun beating down that way. So Yogi's going to play left field in the World Series, and of course he's skilled as a catcher, but he's doing what's best for the team. And one of the writers got very much interested in the fact that he's going to play this difficult position because of the sun. And so he asked Yogi if he thought he would have trouble in left field. And Yogi said, it's a tough field to play. He said, why do you think it's so tough to play, Yogi? He says, the sun sets sooner in left field. He used to attend all the events at Cooperstown, all the Hall of Fame inductions. And Cooperstown, New York, is not an easy place to get to. It's up in the hinterlands. It's up in upstate New York. And you got to be really cognizant of the highways and the roads, because you don't get on the main channels to get up there. So Yogi was on his way up there with his wife, Carmen. He lived in New Jersey in Montclair, and he came across the George Washington Bridge, got over into New York, and he started up towards Cooperstown. And after about an hour and a half, Carmen's looking out the window and looking around and looking at the map, and she said, Yogi, you're lost. He said, I know it, but we're making awfully good time. He invested in a drink called Yoo-Hoo, and I remember it to this day because it was early in his career, in my career. He came to me and he said, I got a chance to invest in a soft drink called Yoo-Hoo. I said, yeah, what do they want? He says, they want $10,000. I said, what do you get for the $10,000? He said, well, he said, they're going to make me in charge of the public relations. I said, that's what you get for the $10,000? He said, yes. I said, Yogi, I'd be careful there. I think maybe that's not too good a deal. So then he asked everybody on the club, 24 different guys, 23, including me, that made 24. And he got the same answer from 24 straight guys. Don't do it. Next game he came to the ballpark. I said, what'd you do about Yoo-Hoo? He said, I gave him 10,000. I said, why'd you do that? He said, Carmen, his wife, told him to. Yoo-Hoo is still in business today. He made a fortune on Yoo-Hoo. And on his first winter, when he was the head of public relations, he came to Dallas for a soft drink convention. And he had a press conference where he had to extol the nutrient value of Yoo-Hoo. And before he started, one of the reporters raised his hand and said, Yogi, is Yoo-Hoo hyphenated? He said, hell no. He said, there's not a bubble in that stuff. Now, as I was in medical school when I was playing, I called my dean the first year that we were in the World Series in 1947. And I called Dr. Lapham, my dean, and I said, Dr. Lapham, I said, we're playing the Dodgers in the World Series. Why don't you come up and watch a game or two? He said he'd like to, but he had plenty of conferences and whatnot that week, and he just couldn't get away. So he said, I'd like to come up some other time. I said, okay, well, I'll give you a rain check. So we beat the Dodgers that year in 7 games. Next year, we didn't win. Cleveland won, 48. They were in a playoff with the Red Sox and beat the Red Sox, and then they played the Braves, and they beat the Braves. 49, we win the pennant again, and we're in against the Dodgers, and I called Dr. Lapham. I said, Dr. Lapham, why don't you come up and watch us? We're going to play the Dodgers again. He said, I got the same problem I had in 1947. He said, I've got to attend all these meetings, and I just can't get away. He said, I promise you I'll come the next time. I said, Dr. Lapham, we don't win every year. And you know I'm not going to play forever. So I said, you shouldn't pass up these opportunities. He said, I promise I'll come the next year. Next year we win again. Now we're in against the Phillies. And I called him with the first 2 games were going to be in Philadelphia, next 3 games in New York, and the final 2 games back in Philadelphia if we needed to play. So we win the first 2 games in Cleveland, in Philadelphia. And I had called Dr. Lapham, and I told him, we play Wednesday and Thursday in Philadelphia. Friday we're off. We play Saturday, Sunday, and Monday in the stadium. And then we're off, and then we play Tuesday and Wednesday. He said, I think I can get up there for Sunday's game. I said, don't stay any longer. Don't waste another game. I said, we might win 4 straight games. He said, I'll be there for Sunday. I'll get in Saturday night, and I'll go there for Sunday. So sure enough, he came in Saturday night. And so I told my folks that I'd have the dean sit with them at the game the next day. We won game 3, and so we're up 3 games to zip. We play in the 4th game, and I came up in the 9th inning. We were ahead, I think, 4-1 or so. And I hit a triple, which was good. The dean was watching, and we won the game. I think we finally won 4-2, 4-3. I can't remember. But we win in 4 games, and I told my dad, now we win. You bring the dean down into the clubhouse so he can see what goes on. So in those days, of course, we didn't have females in the clubhouse. And so there's all sets of, all types of dress. You got some guys running around stark naked. You got some in their shorts. You got some fully clothed, and they're all squirting the champagne and hollering and so forth. And they brought the dean down, and he's bug-eyed seeing this scene. And he's looking over the whole clubhouse, and I said, Dr. Lapham, I want you to meet some of the players. And I looked across the clubhouse floor, and there was Yogi. He was what baseball players wore then, maybe even now. The first thing we would put on, we would get long winter underwear, and we would cut the legs off at the knees, and that's what we wear because it was tight-fitting, and it gave you a little bit of protection when you would slide. So Yogi was in that, he was in just those briefs. And if you were a follower of Charles Darwin and you saw Yogi in his shorts, you got very excited. So I took the dean over to meet Yogi. I said, "Dr. Lappin, this is Yogi Berra." And Yogi, I said, "This is the dean of my medical school. This is Dr. Max Lappin." And Dr. Lappin was very nice to Yogi. He told me he was glad to meet him and congratulations on the series and whatnot. And Yogi kept looking at him, grunted a few times. And then finally, when Dr. Lappin stopped talking, he said, "You really the dean?" He said, "Yes, I'm the dean at Tulane Medical School." And Yogi said, "Well, let me tell you something, Dean. You got some shitty school down there if that dope can pass." Everybody laughs at it. I never have thought it was too funny, to be honest with you. As I told you, Yogi was a bad ball hitter. And he used to drive a pitcher for Detroit named Freddie Hutchinson crazy. Freddie Hutchinson was a very skilled pitcher who could pitch the spots and who could mix up his pitches and keep hitters off balance. And he could seem to get into a hitter's head, and he always seemed to be able to give the hitter a pitch that he wasn't looking for. But he had trouble with Yogi, because Yogi, as I said, if he could reach it, he thought he could hit it. And he didn't think too much up there. If the ball came in and they threw it at him, it threw over the plate, he'd pop it. So this day we're playing in Detroit, and Yogi came up in that first inning, hitting third, and he got two quick strikes on him. Hutchinson got two quick strikes on Yogi, and then he thought he would waste a pitch and see if he could get him to go for a bad ball. And he threw one about even with Yogi's, the peak of his cap. And Yogi went, whoom, right into the upper deck with the wasted pitch. And Hutchinson, who had a violent temper, just exploded on the mound. He was so mad. Now, Yogi had when he would trot, he had kind of like a waddle. And he started waddling to first, and then as he rounded first and started for second, Hutchinson charged off the mound, and he ran over to the infield, and he's screaming at Yogi, and Yogi's watching him. Yogi hit second base and kept watching him, and he started for third. Hutchinson followed him all the way around to third, still screaming and hollering at him, and when Yogi turned third and came for home, Hutchinson hollered one last shout and then went back to the mound. And when Yogi came into the clubhouse, I come into the dugout, I said, "What was wrong with Hutch? What was he hollering at you?" He said, "He kept hollering at me, run on all fours like you're supposed to. Run on all fours like you're supposed to." Yogi, in 1947, that was our first year, and he played for the American Legion post in St. Louis. I forget the name of the post, but it was the American Legion post, and they were going to have a day for him in Sportsman's Park, and I think they were going to give him a car, and so he came to me and said, "I have to give a speech." And I said, "Well, you make it up." I said, "What you need to do is just make one or two sentences and thank them. Don't try to memorize something. Just make it up." And so he said, "Oh, don't you think you ought to write it?" I said, "No, I don't think I ought to write it." I said, "It's your talk, and they're not expecting some Gettysburg address." I said, "You just tell them that you're thanking, and you that you enjoy St. Louis and it's your home and that you just think it was a wonderful day. So he said, okay. And so, but 2 weeks later, he said to me, I think I got my speech. I said, okay, what is it? He said, I want to thank all the people of St. Louis and the members of the American Legion post number so-and-so and so-and-so for making this day possible. Thank you very much. I said, that's fine. I said, you got it made. So for the next 10 days, he practiced that speech and went to every guy in the team and said, here's my speech, and I gave it to you. So now they get to the field in Sportsman's Park on his day. They line both teams up, the Browns on one side, the Yankees on the other. Yogi's up there getting all the praise and whatnot. And so they said, Yogi, you want to say a few words? You say, yeah, I'll say a few words. And he said, I want to thank all the people of St. Louis and the members of the such and such American Legion post for making this day necessary. I thought Jeff Heath, who was on the Browns at the time, was going to faint over from laughter. And everybody's laughing, and Yogi can't figure out what was wrong. I said, well, you did everything well, but the last word, instead of saying possible, you said necessary. He said, close enough. I served in Korea with the artillery battalion for, I guess, 11 months. And then I had enough points I could rotate to Japan. And when I first got in the Army, every general, every time I stood in a formation, they called me out, and I had to go see the general because I came from the Yankees, and of course it was publicized throughout the country. You know, here's a doctor playing with the Yankees, and he's called up because he's a doctor. And so in San Antonio, I was the first day I was with all the rest of the doctors that got called up. But the first thing they said was, is there a Lieutenant Brown here? And I raised my hand and said, the general wants to see you. So I went to see the general. He said, we got a terrific baseball team here, which they did have. They had three or four of the American League players that I knew were on that team, and they had all professional players playing for the Brooke Army Medical Center in San Antonio. And he said, we'd like to keep you. We want you to play while you're here, but you're only going to be here for 5 weeks, and I've got orders from the Surgeon General to send you to the Far East. And that was great news to get the first day you're in the service. They say you're going to ship you out. So I got to Tokyo, and they said that they would tell the general in Tokyo I was coming. I said, big deal. And so I got to Tokyo. First day I'm at Camp Drake. Is there a Lieutenant Brown here? I raised my hand. They said, Dr. Shambora down at, General Shambora down at Camp Zama wants to see you. I said, yeah, okay. Down I go. He said, we'd like to keep you here, but he said, if you stay here, I got to either send you to Hokkaido, which was way up northern Japan. I think it was opposite Siberia. He says, you can't get your family here. You have to be up there at least a year. He said, I can send you to Korea. He said, if I were you, I'd go to Korea. I said, General, I'll go to Korea. He said, I'll call the general over in Seoul, and I can't think of his name. It might have been Zinn, but I forget it now. And so I go to Korea. I get into, I guess it was Yeongdong-po, and I'm in formation. They said, is there Lieutenant Brown here? I said, fine, I'm here. So they assigned me to a MASH hospital for about a month, and then after a month they sent me up to the aid station with the artillery battalion. And then I was up there for 10 or 11 months, and I had plenty of points. So when I went on R&R to Tokyo, a lot of the guys that I was in the boot training for doctors in San Antonio were at Tokyo Army Hospital, friends that I'd made when we first got in the service. And they said it was great. They living in Japan, and they had good, real good duty at the big hospital, and seeing all kinds of interesting stuff. And So I decided I'd transfer. So I was in Tokyo, and I guess I got over there in August of 53. And in March of 54, I read in the Stars and Stripes that Joe DiMaggio and Marilyn Monroe, with Lefty O'Doul, the manager of the San Francisco Seals, were coming to Japan to give clinics to the Japanese major league teams that were in spring training. So it said they were going to stay at the Imperial Hotel. So I told my wife, Sarah, you know, that Joe and Marilyn Monroe are going to be over here, and Lefty O'Doul, I said, I'll leave word for Joe to call me, and if he calls me, we may get with him, and I don't know whether he'll call me. You know, you just never know with Joe. You just can't predict, and you can't worry about it. So I called the hotel and told them that you tell Mr. DiMaggio when he registers in that Bobby Brown, Lieutenant Bobby Brown, called, and this is my phone number. I gave him the phone number to give me a call if he so chooses. And so they were due in at about 1 o'clock at the Haneda Airport, which was the airport at that time that was just on the outskirts, maybe in Yokohama, right near Tokyo. The one now, the airport now is maybe 20, 40 miles away. But at that time, it was right close by. And they were due in there about 1 o'clock in the afternoon. And I got home from the hospital about 5. I said to Sarah, have you heard from Joe? She said, no, I haven't heard a thing. So I said, well, you never know. He may call, may not. And we went ahead and had dinner. And she was upstairs getting into her robe and nightgown or whatever about 7:30 or so, and the phone rang. And it was Joe. He said, we just got here. He said, we landed at 1 o'clock. He said, Lefty O'Doul told me. He said, didn't say Lefty. He said, Lefty told me that Marilyn and I ought to come to Japan. It's a foreign country. They won't recognize it. They don't know you. You can go anywhere you want to. Nobody will ask you for any kind of autograph or anything. They just will ignore you. You can do anything you want. And that was right down Joe's alley, see, that they wouldn't have to worry about autographs. He said, we came over here. And that's what Lefty told us. He said, there were 7 million people lining the streets to look at us. He said, we just got here. He said, this is the damnedest thing I ever saw. So he said, why don't you come down and eat with us? I said, Joe, we just ate. I said, he said, well, come down and have some dessert. I said, let me check with Sarah. And she hollered, I'm putting on my stockings. I'm putting on my stockings. And so we went on down and joined them. And so it was at that dinner table that Marilyn said to Joe, Joe, she said, I've got to go to Korea to see all those kids over there. At that time, the armistice had been signed in the previous, I think, August of 53, August or September. And so this is the spring. But we still had 500,000 Army guys over there. And she said, Joe, I'm this close. I've got to go over. He said, no, you don't have to go over there. And he hated the Army. He was in the Army in World War II. He said, no. He said, we're on our honeymoon. We paid our own way over. You don't have to go anywhere. She said, Joe, at this close, I've got to go over there and just do a few things over there. He said, what can you do? She said, well, I can sing a little. Like she had to do anything, you know. All she had to do was show up. And so he said, well, you got to take all those shots and everything. She said, what are you talking about? What do you mean shots? And he said, you know, all those, but he pointed to me, well, tell her what kind of shots she's got to take. Well, I said, yeah, you got to get vaccinated for smallpox, and you'll have to take shots for tetanus and for typhoid, and I went down the gamut of things that you would have to do. And oh, she looked at Joe. She said, Joe, she said, will that leave a scar on my body? Oh, no, he said, only about that long. He said, it won't be it won't be long at all, just maybe 3 or 4 inches. And oh, she said, Joe, I can't have a scar like that on my body. She said to me, will it leave a scar? I said, no, Marilyn, it won't leave a scar. And so Joe laughs. And so he told the Army that nobody in the Army will treat Mrs. DiMaggio except Lieutenant Brown. Now, they had that printed in Stars and Stripes. Stars and Trites went to every outfit in Japan, went to Okinawa, went to the Philippines, it went to Korea, everywhere. You get the Stars and Stripes, everybody in the service. And all the calls began to come into Tokyo. Who the hell is Lieutenant Brown? You know, so anyway, we went on their honeymoon with them. I got temporary duty from the Army, and Joe and I and Lefty O'Doul gave clinics to the Japanese teams, and then Marilyn went over to Korea. Then she came back, and Lefty O'Doul, he had a great-looking wife also, and he called his wife up in the States to get on a plane and get over here. He said, we're having fun. He said, we're gonna be with Marilyn and the Browns and Joe. And she came over, so the three couples had a great time. And this occurred. They had a big reception in Tokyo for Joe and Lefty on Marilyn. And the Japanese at that time, I don't know what they do now, but at that time, only the men went to the receptions. The wives had to stay home. So now we got maybe 300 men, Japanese, all dark suits, all brunettes, in this big room. And two women are in there, Marilyn, platinum blonde, and Sarah, my wife. And there you have this shot of all these people down there, and you can see that blonde hair right in the middle of it all. And we had this big reception. And I was at that reception, and this little guy came up to me and introduced himself. He said, I can't remember whether he called me Dr. Brown or Lieutenant Brown or Bobby Brown or what he called me, but he said, I'm James Michener. And I said, Mr. Michener, I just got through reading your first book, The Fires of Spring, when I was in Korea. I said, the USO dropped that book off to me, and I thought it was terrific. It was of his upbringing in Pennsylvania. He was either in foster homes or he was in some kind of an orphanage. And it was his life as a teenager growing up in Pennsylvania. I said, it's just terrific. I said, I really, really enjoyed it. And he said, do you think, he said, you could introduce me to Joe DiMaggio? I says, you bet. I said, come on with me. So we went over and Joe was talking to somebody, and we stayed there for about 5 minutes while he was talking, and finally the guy left and I introduced. I said, Joe, I want you to meet James Michener. And I said, Mr. Michener, Joe DiMaggio. And we had a nice pleasant talk for about 5 minutes. Michener left. And when he got about 50 feet away, Joe said to me, who the hell was that little guy? I said, Joe, did you see the South Pacific? He said, yeah. I said, he wrote it. And I think what he was doing, and I'm sure of it, he wrote a book called The Bridges of Tokori. And I think he was doing research over in the Orient at that time for that book. In retrospect. But I never did see James Michener again. He lived in Austin. I was tempted sometime to get down there and look him up and ask him if he remembered meeting Joe over in Tokyo. Joe was on a different level than virtually all the players. And it wasn't that he was just a very quiet guy. And again, I don't know. You know, he only had a couple weeks of high school. Because he went to the same high school I went to in San Francisco. Now he was 10 years ahead of me. But he was only there a couple of weeks and he quit. And so I don't think he ever even had a high school education. And I often wondered if that bothered him when everybody wanted to be near him and talk to him and whatnot. But he was a very quiet guy. He never bothered anybody and nobody bothered him. If you wanted to visit with him, you sit down and talk to him, he was extremely pleasant, but he was not going to come to your locker and sit down and shoot the breeze. You know, he just wouldn't do that. So, at any rate, they said that there was some kind of a maybe in the we were talking about the trains and all the hijinks that went on and the pranks and so forth. But Joe was always left out of those things. He didn't participate in it, and no one bothered him. Now, he and Tommy Henrich and Charlie Keller, there were three on that team. Joe came up in 36, I think Henrich in 37, and maybe Keller in 38 or 9, but they were all very close. They were the outfield. It was Joe in center, Keller in left, and Henrich in right. So they were very, very close. They didn't, you know, not necessarily socialize, but on the team, they were really close to each other. So we're in Detroit again, and there's a tunnel that goes from the clubhouse out to the field, and Keller is walking in the tunnel, and there's this frog jumping up and down, and Keller gets it, and he puts it in his pocket, in his back pocket. And what people didn't know at the time, Joe and Rizzuto, they knew about Rizzuto, but they didn't know about Joe, were deathly afraid of bugs that flew and snakes and varmints, you know, they just couldn't stand them. And so in those days, the Yankees made all the players wear garters, and they didn't have knee-length socks. And they made you have garters that hook onto your socks to keep them up, because they didn't want the Yankees sitting around lobbies, the players, with their socks hanging down over their shoes. And they made you you had to travel in a suit on the road, and you had to wear those garters to keep your socks up. And in the clubhouses, they had hooks that were about chest high, where you could hang your clothes with the hangers. And then they had hooks that were about knee high that you could hang your socks or shorts or whatever you wanted to. And what Joe would do is he would hook the garters together so that they were intact, and he would hang them on those hooks. So he had the socks hanging on those hooks, always in those lower hooks. So now Keller's got the frog in his pocket. The team goes out on the field, and when the team's out on the field, he slips back into the clubhouse and he drops that frog in Joe's sock. Now it's in the sock, and in 5 minutes, everybody on the team knows that Joe's got the frog in his sock. So teams all dress alike. There are about five guys that take 10 minutes to shower, dress, and leave. Boom, they're gone. You've got maybe 10, 12 guys, 15 guys that take more time. They take maybe 30 minutes. They take a little more time taking their uniform off and talking over the game and going to the shower and taking their time drying off and putting their clothes on. And then you got four or five guys that take forever. They're always the last. But the last guy always to get through with showering and dressing was Joe. And the bus would wait outside the clubhouse if you were on the road, and everybody would be in the bus waiting, and that front seat on the right was Joe's seat. Nobody would sit in that. He'd walk out, he'd sit in the seat, and they'd close the doors, and we'd head for the hotel. So now, the Joe's got the frog in his sock. Now the whole team comes in. The fast guys are not so fast today. They're taking their time. They're looking at their mail and whatnot, and they're all watching Joe. And Joe's sitting there in his sweatshirt and shorts and smoking a cigarette and drinking coffee and just meditating, and no one bothers him, see. So finally the fast guys go in, and they take their time, and they come out, and they get dressed slowly. And then the other guys begin to filter in the shower and come back. So Joe doesn't notice that the clubhouse is not emptying. See, they're all in there reading the papers, they're looking at their mail, they're out the training room and whatnot, all watching Joe, see. And Joe goes in and he sits there for, you know, 30 minutes or so, and then he goes into the shower and he comes back and he towels off and he puts on his shorts, and everybody's kind of watching, they're not saying a word. And Joe picks up the sock, and it jumps right out of his hand, see? And it hits the floor, and it starts jumping down the floor. Joe jumps up on the stool that they were sitting. Every locker locker has a stool in front of it, and Joe jumps up on the stool. He's up there in his underwear watching this frog, and he's as white as a sheet. And there's not a sound in the clubhouse. Yeah, the frog's going down there. And everybody's just kind of watching, like, you know, this. And Keller gets up, and after it took about six jumps down, he went down, he caught the sock. He went in, reached in, took the frog out. He went over to Joe's locker, and Joe's watching him all the way, see? And he hangs up the sock on the hook. He goes down in the tunnel, throws the frog in the tunnel. Everybody gets up and goes out and sits in the bus. And no one ever says a word. Joe gets dressed, comes out in the club, there's just a silence and everything, and they walk, go back to the hotel. And I told Paul I had the greatest urge to ask Joe about that frog when we was on that honeymoon. But I never had enough guts. I just didn't have enough guts. But that was one of the funniest things I ever saw, and there wasn't a laugh, there wasn't a word spoken, and nothing ever said later on. Just amazing. You never could tell whether Joe popped up, struck out, or hit a home run. He didn't strike out much. He didn't pop up much. He had the same look on his face. He ran the same way around the bases. It wasn't too fast or too slow. He did everything the right way. And he never put on a show or never pointed up at the sky or did all that crap that they do now. And he just was that way. He hit a ball, the first left center was 462 feet. And he hit those balls 450 feet out there and they'd catch him. Or 460 feet and they'd catch him at the fence. He hit this one day and you could just see he was really upset. He was at second base virtually when they caught the ball. And in those days, you know, we didn't have any of the materials that they have now. They put oil of wintergreen? They would put in the buckets of water, the ice water. They would put something in that water that would, you'd take it and you could almost feel it open up your nasal passages and whatnot.
Was it ammonia water?
No, it wasn't ammonia. It was something. I think it was oil of wintergreen or some damn thing. Anyway, there was kind of a soothing smell that you would take. And you take that cold sponge out, I say, and it'd be, you know, it had no fans, and you had the big woolen uniforms and all that stuff. So the bucket was sitting there on the dugout floor, and it was right next to the stanchion that held up the roof. And Joe came in, and he saw that bucket, and he hauled off and kicked it. You know, we had just kangaroo skin shoes, very light. And he kicked that bucket, and instead of the bucket flying down, it hit that pole. It was, and it never moved. And the one side came all the way in and touched the other side like that he did with his foot. And we thought he broke his foot. And boy, you could hear a pin drop because we just, and he never said he didn't say ouch or didn't, he just sat there and chewed his gum. And when the inning was over, he got up and ran out to center field, and everybody said, "Is he limping? Is he limping? Does he look okay?" You know, he breaks his foot. We don't get in the World Series. You know, it's just it's that simple. He went out there and played, and never said anything. But when I was on that honeymoon, I asked him. I said, "Joe, you remember that time you kicked that bucket?" He said, "I thought my foot came off." "Oh," he said, "did it hurt?" "I wasn't going to let you guys know that it hurt me. I had the hell with you. Yeah, I just wouldn't let any of you know anything about it." He said, I just thought I'd shake it off. I said, "But boy," he said, "I thought that my foot was going to come off." I didn't get a chance to go to spring training much after 1947. When I got into my internship, I actually got there, I guess it was in 51. I got there the day before the season was to open. And first players that I met was Mickey Mantle. This was his first year up. And he looked at me, he says, "Where you been?" Well, I said, "I've been interning." He said, "What do you mean interning? What's that?" He said, "Is that a job?" I said, "No." I said, "After you get through medical school,
I said, you have to intern for a year before you can take care of patients. You can be, or you can practice. And he said, what do you mean school? Did you go have to go to school? I said, yes. He said, what kind of school? I said, I went to medical school. He says, how long were you there? Well, I said, I was playing ball, so it took me 6 years to get through. 6 years to go to school? I said, yes. Oh, boy, he said. So didn't say much more. Now, the next day as the season opens, and Mickey and I are standing on the top step of the dugout watching the goings-on at home plate. And in those days, of course, they had some of the cameras with the shrouds that went over the person's, the photographer's head, and they looked through the big box camera, which is on a tripod, and they took pictures. And then they had flash cameras, and they had the two dignitaries. I think they had Governor Dewey from New York pitching to Mayor Pelletieri of New York City. And they got the first ball pitched, and then everything broke up. The photographers and the newspaper men were up there, and the photographers started coming over toward the dugout. And they had to get out of the exit that was right by the Yankee dugout on the first base side. And I was watching this somewhat elderly photographer who was struggling with his tripod, finally got it and got it on his shoulder and came walking over toward us. And when he got within about 4 or 5 feet of us, I looked at him, I was watching him. You could see his eyes roll up into his head, and I knew he was gonna fall and faint. And I jumped up and I told Mickey, help me, Mick, and we caught him. And he began to have this agonal breathing where you knew that he was in deep trouble. And he began to get cyanotic, began to get blue. And we looked at him. I said, Mickey, something's really bad has happened here. We got to get him into the clubhouse. Let's carry him in. So the two of us picked him up and carried him on in. And you could tell that he was in tremendous distress. And we got him into the training room, and we put him on the table. And as we got him on the table, Mickey retreated to the door, to the training room, and sat there and stood there and watched. And of course, I tried to find a pulse. He had no pulse, no carotid pulses, no radial pulses. And you could tell he was dying. And within about 2 or 3 minutes, he stopped breathing, and he had obviously died and had no pulse at any time. And so I told the trainer, he just passed away. I said, you got to call the team doctor and tell him what happened so he knows, and then you may have to call the coroner to have him come examine the body. And then I started back, and I saw Mickey at the door. He said, did you help him? I said, no, Mickey, I couldn't. I think he had a big catastrophe. Either he had a change in his heart rhythm that he couldn't handle, or he ruptured a huge vessel somewhere, a blood vessel somewhere. He said, you mean you couldn't help him? I said, no, I really couldn't. He said, you went to school all that time and you couldn't help him? And I said, that's right, I just couldn't. It just had to happen sometimes. So he thought for a minute. He said, hey. He said, was that your first patient? And I thought for a minute, you know, I'd been in my internship, but I always had somebody over me, was taking care of the patients. And I said, you know, to myself, that this is the first time I've ever had something all by myself this way. So I said, yes. I said, I guess it is my first patient. Oh, he said, what a horrible way to break in. So now time marches on, and I guess it was 20 years later. You know, Mickey was living here in Dallas. I was practicing over in Fort Worth, and I read in the paper he was getting some big award at Adolphus Hotel. And so I decided I would go over after doing my practice that day. And I got through late, of course, and got over there. And I got over there when dinner was almost over. And because of the overflow, they had some chairs up in the balcony. So I jumped up those stairs and got into the balcony and got a seat. And I looked down, and there, looking right straight at me from the stage, was Mickey. He's looking right at me, and he gives me the little wave, and I give him the little wave. And then they start the program. And when they introduce Mickey, he said, "Listen," he said, "before I start, let's get Bobby Brown down here. Let him tell you about his first patient." Now I'll end this little tirade with an account of my most memorable consult. This was in the early 60s. I got to Fort Worth in 1958 and began to practice cardiology. And as Paul told you, I practiced for 25 years. But this was in 1961 or 1962. And my partner and I had a two-man office. And so we alternated weekends and nights on call. And it was my turn on the weekend. And so on Saturday morning, I got this call from one of the family practitioners. Said he had a patient in Harris Hospital that they'd put in on Friday. He was going to have surgery on Monday, but there was a question about whether or not he'd had so many coronary artery trouble, and would I mind going by to see him and clear him for surgery if it was permissible? So I said, sure, I would. So early that Saturday afternoon, I go over to Harris Hospital. He was up on the fourth floor, and I went up there, and he was in a two-bedroom room. And his bed, the patient that I was going to see, was next to the wall and the window. The other patient was next to the door. And in between the bed, around along the ceiling, they had this wire, and they had a sheet on it, so that when the doctor was examining one of the patients, if he wanted a little semi-privacy, he could pull that sheet down between the beds so you could hear everything, but you couldn't see everything. So I found out my patient was next to the wall. I went and introduced myself, told him I was a heart doctor, and that his doctor wanted me to check him out and to make sure he was okay for surgery. And I pulled that sheet, pulled it through, down the whole wire, length of the wire, so that we had that blocked off. And at the foot of the bed, about two-thirds of the way up the wall, was a TV set. And each patient had a remote on his bedstand. And the TV was off when I started. And I took the history from my patient. He wasn't too enthused about the whole thing. I wasn't either, to be honest with you. But I took the history, and then I began examining him. And I did the eye exam and looked at his throat and felt his neck and felt his carotid pulses and listened to see if there were any sounds over the carotids. And then I got down and listened to the lungs, and I was just getting ready to put the stethoscope and listen to his heart when I realized that the other patient had turned on the TV. And I listened, and Saturday afternoon, it was a ball game, and the announcer was very familiar, and I said, "That's Mel Allen, who broadcasted the Yankee games when I played, and he had retired." And I said real quickly to myself, they must have a rainout. This was the game of the week that Major League Baseball did every Saturday, and they must have a rainout, and they're playing an old game. And then he said, "Hatton is getting ready to pitch to DiMaggio." And when he said that, I knew exactly what game he was talking about. Joe Hatton was pitching for the Dodgers, and Joe Hatton and I played on the same semi-pro team in San Francisco. Now, he's with the Dodgers, I'm with the Yankees. And when he said he's going to pitch to DiMaggio, I knew exactly what it was, because he said that Henrik was on third, Berra was on second, first base was open, and they were going to walk DiMaggio. I knew all this because, see, I was the next hitter. So I took my stethoscope out of my ears, and I pointed up to the TV set to the patient. I said, "You watch that up there now." I said, "I'm going to come up, and I'm going to hit this ball with those three guys on base. I'm going to hit it against that right field wall." I said, "You'll see Henrik score, Berra will score, DiMaggio will score, and I'll slide in the third." And then I put the stethoscope back in my ears, and this guy's eyes are open like that, and he's looking at me like I just got off the spaceship from Mars, I tell you. So sure enough, Mel Allen says, well, they're walking to DiMaggio. There's ball four. He said, Bobby Brown's coming up to hit, and they got two quick strikes on Brown. And then here's the third pitch, and there goes the line drive. He said, it's over Hodge's head at first. It's heading for the wall. It's up against the wall. It's back over Hermanski's head. He said, well, Hermanski's chasing the ball. He said, Henrik has scored. Berra scored. Here comes DiMaggio scoring. He says, Brown slides in the third with a triple. And with that, the sheet goes flying back open. The guy in the next bed has jumped out of bed. He's looking at me. He said, who the hell are you? He said, are you really a doctor? Thank you all.
Was Jackie Robinson safe or out in his attempt to steal home in the World Series?
I guess it was maybe 10, 15 years ago. I was at Cooperstown for the induction ceremony. When I was in the American League office, so it was longer than that. So I had to go up to Cooperstown every induction. And, of course, Yogi went every induction, and we'd always get together up there and visit. And in Cooperstown, they have a room that's, I'm going to say, maybe about as big as this section here, where they have a constant video on of great moments in baseball. And it runs all the time, and people come and go. And they come in and watch it and go and so forth. And Yogi and I wander in there. And we're sitting there, and there's about 40 or 50 people around there. And all of a sudden, I'm looking at the video, at the disc, and there's Dax Jackie dancing off third base, and I know what's coming, and I can see Yogi begin to tense up. And as he's coming in and slides, Yogi's on his feet. He's hollering, you're out! You're out, you son of a bitch! You're out! You're out! And he got so mad, he left the stadium. He left the theater. So I guess Yogi thought he was out, and he probably was if Yogi said he was out.